was no second pilot in a Lancaster bomber. Everything depended on the flying skill and, in the end, the character of one man. Wickenby was the home of 12 Squadron, whose motto was Leads the Field. 23 Lancs was the full complement of bombers. In the week before the replacement crew arrived at their new home, weary and footsore, in need of a bed to flop out on, 8 of these great planes had failed to return. 56 men had bled, burned, and fallen to earth. The name of the new sergeant pilot was Jack Currie.
Well, this was Wickenby when we got here. Not like this. But it was pretty obviously an operational base. Such a bloody awful place, it couldn't really have been anything else. Windblown, desolate, miles from anywhere. It's more or less what we expected. There were 7 of us in the crew. 3 Australians and 4 British. We were all sergeants, except for the navigator. He was an officer, all from widely differing backgrounds. We didn't really have all that much in common. One thing, I suppose, we were usually hungry. The food was you needed a good appetite to enjoy it. Lots of sausages and baked beans, little peas like buckshot, and slices of unidentified meat.
The squadron base, although literally surrounded by others, dozens of others, was a little principality all of its own. Its foreign policy was simple enough: attack Germany. That aside, there was little that was tremendously exciting. It was a tiny state with no elder statesmen, and only the diversions of youth.
The other form of amusement on the camp, I suppose you have to say, was the waffery. There was a dark-eyed girl in the MT section. She was beautiful. But she had bad luck with her boyfriends. The pilot, a gunner, they both went missing. And then she turned to a civilian in the works department and he killed himself on a motor bicycle. I made a date with her, meet her here. And there was a tannoy message for me, my name, ringing all over the camp 10 minutes before I was due to meet her. Report to some officer, some other place on the base. I got there was nobody there. Found myself in an empty map room, locked in. When I got out about an hour later, nobody knew anything about a tannoy call, not Lanham, not anybody. I hadn't realized what a superstitious lot they were. So I never did lay that jinx. I saw her on that first night, driving a crew bus, taking the crews out to dispersal for a takeoff. I found a place to lie on a bank in the grass on the side of the perimeter track. Listened, watched. All the engines started up, 60 Merlin engines. Until the airfield was full of noise and moving aircraft. One taxied quite close by me, close enough for me to see the mid-upper gunner's face behind his gun barrels. My thumb up to him, waved his hand back.
In 1943, Bomber Command opened up airfields all over Lincolnshire to add to their growing list in the county. Their names, once glorious, the subjects of alarms by night, human tragedies, most urgent signals, have now returned to village cricket teams. Bardney, Dunham Lodge, Ludford Magna, Kelston, Spilsby, Killingholme. And that was only the vintage of 43. In all, 29 bomber bases were operational in Lincolnshire by the end of the war. Over 30,000 acres of land were purchased by the Air Ministry. RAF Wickenby, was built on fields once farmed by Mr. Bowser, who is alive today, a frail old man of 84.
The first thing I knew, there was a gentleman came to the door and asked, would you take me a tour on your top land on the farm? So I said, oh yes. I said, and what's your requirements? So he says, well, we're thinking of an airfield here. I said, thank you very much. And so I said, what about the crops? Oh, he said, take the notice of those. He says, we can't bother about crops. Well, these surveyors came in the morning and they said, oh, well, we shall be here in a few days' time. But at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, a bulldozer got there, he'd gone through one of my hedges, let all my cattle out, and came home. And that was the first thing I knew about the airfield.
A total of 721 Lancs were based in Lincolnshire by the end of the war. Every one of those planes stood in the shadow of five others destroyed by enemy action. And the 5,500 air crew represented only the glamorous tip of the RAF iceberg. 10 times as many RAF uniforms were to be seen around the quiet lanes and isolated country pubs, or sculling around Lincoln. Fitters, airframe mechanics, armourers, signals, planning, MET, intelligence. And for Currie, the new boy, Wickenby was a place to tread carefully. His new air gunner, Lanham, had Australian manners when it came to arguments. He expected to win them. There was a term in the RAF, lack of moral fibre, covering all forms of despair, defeatism and cowardice. Inevitably it existed. Lanham already had enough operational hours to recognise it and saw the vital need to make Jack do the same. In that first week, when they met a flight sergeant out on the perimeter track, who told them they couldn't last a week of ops, Lanham quickly jumped in, without sparing the feelings of his new skipper. To Jack's embarrassment, there was no small talk, no forgiveness. The Australian brutally crushed the defeatist. He marked his new pilot's card for him. No LMF, no whinging, no pity. Survival at all costs. All the same, there was a term for a new crew, Lanham or no Lanham. They were a SPROG crew, yet to go airborne, even in training. It was common knowledge that only one in three crews had a chance of completing an operational tour of 30 missions. After the first five missions, the betting improved to evens. It never shortened to odds on. Over 56,000 men posted to Bomber Command never went home.
There are quite a lot of superstitions and good luck charms around. Fellas used to hang odd pieces of their girlfriend's underwear around their necks. Pretty unhygienic, some of that stuff. On that first trip, I saw this notice in the locker room when I was getting kitted up. It said, hand your locker key into the NCOIC locker room. So I said, what's that about? And they said, well, that's to save them busting the door of the locker open if you don't come back. So I said, oh, no, I'm coming back all right. And I always kept that locker key in my pocket after that. And that damn great cathedral up there looks as though it's floating over Lincoln. That was a sort of symbol of faith in the future, as far as I was concerned, and a link with the past. The thing that kept me pretty cheerful all through was confidence in the aeroplane and in the crew.
They had been trained and gathered together to fly Lancasters, generally acknowledged to be the finest bomber of World War II.
When the designers had built the Lancaster to carry a lot of bombs, they were to be seen walking outside, looking worried around the aircraft. They were trying to find somewhere to put the crew in. But you see, there isn't really all that much room in here, and it's rather awkward to clamber about, but I want to show you the rear turret where Lanham spent his operational tour. loneliest place in the aircraft. The only connection with the rest of the crew, the intercom. Well, the navigator was supposed to be able to tell me where we were going, but the rear gunner was in an ideal position to tell me where we'd been. Well, it was an advantage to be small and agile to get into the rear turret, and that's certainly true of this, the mid-upper turret. Fortunately, I had a very agile Welsh midget. It was a good shot, too. Called me up one night, coming back from Berlin, asked for permission to leave the turret to clean up. I said, what's the matter? He said that he'd been passing wind, and or at least he thought he had, he'd followed through a little strong. And so I said, no, I'm sorry, you can't do that, George. There are 500 night fighters out there looking for us. You've got to stay in the turret. I remembered about him when we were back over the North Sea some 3-4 hours later. And I said, you can get out and clean up now, George. He said, well, I don't think I'll bother, Skipper. It's baked hard. Mid-upper turret. We come to the main spar, the dreaded main spar where the wings join the fuselage. Barked many a shin. Come to the astrodome. A good vision from here. And, of course, the navigator would take his astro shots from there if he had no other form of navigation. It would be good to within about 10 miles or so, provided he could see the stars. The wireless operator's set. He'd be listening in on the medium wave for the broadcasts every half hour, get the latest winds, but no broadcasting ourselves. That might give our position away. Now through to the navigator's compartment. Right here, G-box, various repeaters of pilot's instruments as well. And the navigator, he had his problems too. He used to be sick every trip, always very neatly into a little sick bag that he carried in his navigation bag. I asked him, I'd go and see the doctor about it. He said, oh, no. Dan gave us the honors. He said, that's all right. It's something I've learned to live with. Now we're going down into the bomb aimer's compartment. Again, it's handy to be agile. The bomb aimer wasn't a particularly imaginative fellow. In fact, you might almost say that he was a little insensitive. A good old block of Australian wood was our Larry. His main thought, I think, when he pressed the tip was getting a really good aiming point photograph. Without too much concern as what was happening down in the streets below. That may have been just as well. Well, as far as I was concerned, this was the place to be. The pilot's seat in number one bomber, World War II. I wonder if I can remember the starting drill. Ground flight switch on ground. That is so that we don't use up the aircraft batteries, use the external battery instead. Then throttles set, like just putting your foot on the accelerator of your car a little bit before you press the button. Pitch fully fine and locked. Okay. Supercharger, medium gear. Rad shutters automatic. That's all right. Fuel, now we ought to have number two tanks selected. And booster pumps on. I have a flight engineer doing all this for me. Ignition. Oops. And just have number three. Number three ready to go. Contact number three.
They flew training flights. The first time of taking off, tension, however disguised. Currie had the lives of six of his fellow human beings in his hands, and he, all of them, were practicing hard to destroy perhaps thousands.
Follow me through on the throttles. Get on your own here. Lock it on, please. Lock on. The carriage up, engine.
And
out.
The carriage coming up.
My throttles. Lock these flowers. Lock it, lock it. Lock it. No, still not locked. Just lock the throttles, please. Still not locked. 2650, please.
That was in the future still. For the time being, they found confidence in each other, settled together as a crew, gathered the discipline they needed, felt the sense of relief that comes from being a good team.
This was our local pub. Not that I came here very often. The rear gunner Lanham would go crook on me if I did. He would only let me drink on stand-ons or on leave. On stand-ons, we'd usually go into Lincoln. I suppose we brought the occasional waff in here. None of us was married. Well, apart from miring the bomb aimer, we weren't altogether sure about that. But in those early days, we weren't really all that interested in beer or waffs, to be honest. We were really only interested in seeing what names were going to be on the battle order and what the target was.
And it came soon enough, Target Cologne. Jack was rostered to DV200, Freddy 2. If the odds could be written up, as they do in betting shops nowadays, it was odds on their last night on Earth, somewhere above the Earth, over a foreign city not one of them had ever visited.
Hey, Doug.
For the operation tonight, all our aircraft are on the same target.
First, rulers and pencils, and close attention to the Met forecast and details of the cloud base, winds, figures all to be memorized against future suns.
Watches, gentlemen.
Then, almost unbelievably, the pin-sharp silence as they synchronized watches on the bombing leader's mark.
Now.
There are men watching this film now, tonight, or who may one day in Perth or Sydney, Melbourne or Adelaide, who can say the following list by heart or in their sleep. Lanham, Protheroe, Cassidy, Fairburn, Myring, Walker, Jack Currie, F for Freddy too. Those who lived in Lincoln during the war remember the long, long climb of planes flying up to reach operating height. The sky filled with noise as squadron after squadron formed the swarm. Children early to bed in those days could hear the walls of the house shiver as hundreds of planes were put up one by one from all over the county. Flying away from the setting sun at no more than an agonizing 150 miles an hour, nearly 30 tons urged across the North Sea in company with hundreds of other planes, in almost all of them crews, 1,000 or more men, strangers to each other. And until the war, strangers to the business of flying and killing. A mass of machines crossed Belgium towards Target.
Half a minute to go. Okay, thanks for that. Keep waving. Hello, engineer. Skipper here. Yeah, will you put the revs up, please?
The bomber stream ended over the Target. After the bomb's gone, the navigator, Cassidy, set a pre-arranged course on a series of legs that took them, now, away from the rising sun towards the crisp Lincolnshire dawn and its empty skies and friendly fields.
Took me by the throat a little. But going back to that first raid, that was a typical medium range bomber mission of 1943. We had lots more, all very different. Sometimes lots more trouble. The hold a bit, lost a couple of engines on fire, lost a few chunks in a thunderstorm, ran out of oxygen, ran out of fuel, got lost, all that stuff. But you got it there in that Cologne raid. The story of the pilot and the crew starting off. You got the noise and the darkness and the flashes and the sudden frights and all that. Everything really except for the smell that I noticed just now, or thought I noticed, the glycol and the leather and chewing gum, the metal and oxygen.
Sergeant Pilot Currie left the RAF as squadron leader and retired in 1964. Wickenby reverted to use as a civil airport and is still in operation today. A few years ago, Jack Currie wrote a gripping and moving book of his wartime years, Lancaster Target. You can find the paperback on station bookstalls. He lives in Easingworld nowadays. Of his crew, the man he has kept in touch with most has been Charlie Lanham. They were, as it turned out, a lucky crew. In a sense, they were doubly lucky.